Hello, this is the Lego Star Wars Rogue One AT-ST Walker set. We haven't gotten an AT-ST from Lego and minifig scale in quite some time, and I think this one here looks pretty nice. The build was definitely pretty nice, and it's pretty stable. However, it does not have the ability to walk. It's still something that they just haven't been able to figure out with the limitations of physics and small sizes for the legs of the chicken walker itself. This does have the ability to turn the legs back like this, but you have no articulation in the ankles. So you're realistically limited to just having it standing straight up. However, the head, as you can see, is able to turn to the side, and they have a nicely disguised knob here to allow you to remotely move that around. And it really makes the thing look alive, doesn't it? Look at that. I mean, yeah, my hand is there, but you know, I'm making small movements and it just looks very alive. And it actually has a semi-ratcheted joint, the large turntable, 4x4 turntable. So that's why you may hear a little bit of sound in the background, and it's just a little bit notchy. But I'm okay with that because it will hold it in place so it won't just, you know, fall back down to a forward position. The shaping here is pretty nice. Has a little bit of gappiness around the sides as viewed from the front, but given that everything is angled on two axes there, I think this actually came together pretty nicely. Got your light blasters over here, which can be turned up and down. Cannons up at the front can be turned up and down. And on the other side is a representation of a grenade launcher unit that can also be turned up and down. And this has spring-loaded shooters built into it. It's those longer ones. You can see the red tips of them there. You can see them more obviously from the side. I don't like seeing those myself, so on display, I would just leave those out. They have remote triggers or activation points for those. You push on these points back here to shoot those off. So, there goes that one. And there goes that one. Works quite well. Couple of stickers used back here, I'm so glad that that is just a gray piece that they use there rather than doing the normal thing that they're used to of, you know, putting a bright yellow or red piece with a sticker on top of it that shows you that, hey, you can turn it left and right. It's just fine to leave it like that. These legs, though they're not as poseable as I would like them to be, they are very thin and effective, and they hold together well and have a good level of detail. My favorite thing is the inclusion of these linkages back here, which fit just perfectly. Again, too bad they don't actually do anything. They don't actually provide stability as far as I can tell, but they look good. My least favorite thing here is the use of blue Technic pins and axle pins. If those weren't in blue, this would look so much better. I'm glad that they used some tiles out here to cover up some of the Technic stuff. Some of the, you know, the insides are not like that. They're left open, but that's easy to correct with a handful of extra parts. But I'm glad that at least the outsides are done well. And they used a couple of stickers on the feet, well, one per. And I think they look just fine. I like the shaping of those. There's a lot of shaping that I like of this whole thing, including these covers for the tops of the ports. And if you look at this from just the right angle, and Lego actually put it on their box to show you that you could actually see the driver inside. So I have placed the driver inside, but light doesn't get in there very easily. You can see that his face is right there. Let me see if I can get some light in there by opening up the hatch. You can see it just a little bit. The hatch is really nice, built up and kind of greebled around the outsides more than I would have expected. Just a single sticker is used there. And this is, you know, it's an effective thing, but of course they do have the ability to open up the entire top of this, which exposes some of the interior shaping and building, which isn't all that great to look at, but it is the inside, and I think it's more than forgivable. They have a spot for a thermal detonator back there. The guy, the driver, sits in place without using any studs. He's just attached with friction to a panel piece in the front that just holds onto his legs. And he has a very generous console that is, again, a sticker, but It's a pretty large one, and I like it. And that is well designed, perfectly inspired by the actual prop. I haven't seen the interior of the Rogue One version, but it should be very, very similar to what we saw in the original trilogy. So this looks good in that sense. The AT-ST driver figure itself has a print on the helmet this time around, which shows his optional visor or shield goggles that he can bring down across his face. And just look at the level of detail going all the way through the torso, the hips, and the legs. So the belt is printed on the torso, and then they have some of the creasing and edges of from the trousers of the tops of the pockets and some of the stitching that's actually covered in the hip piece there. That's printed up pretty nicely. It's just incredible how far Lego has come with their level of detail with their figures. I mean, not too many years ago, something like this would only be possible to get on a completely custom figure. Same thing with this Rebel Trooper figure, who has a nice level of detail, some very fine lines in the torso, printed hip piece, and then printed legs as well, although the leg printing is relatively subtle here because it's dark gray against reddish brown, just a little bit difficult to see. But then on the Trooper, look at his helmet. That's two colors. It's the nougat color and gunmetal gray, and that's very nicely done, and also has the insignia that's printed over on this side. So another really good figure. And then Blaze Malbus on the far right, one of the core characters. I really like the build of his blaster there, mostly for the fact that it is actually a build and not just, you know, a preformed part or two that are put together. It's got the power source or fuel supply on the back. Sorry, this is just a little bit off. I need to angle it. There, that's a little bit better. But I just like actually built, you know, minifigure weapons. And this one looks pretty good. Get it angled up like that. See, it makes more sense. Simple enough. It's not huge, you know. Doesn't make the figure really, really front heavy. It is possible to get it to stand with the blaster out like this. And then talking about level of detail, look just how much he has on his torso. And also again, whoa, too far. Also again, printing on the hips and on the legs. Not as much level of detail on the legs here. I guess some of the lines. It feels a little bit lower in resolution to me, but it really isn't. And then the faces, here they are with all the headgear removed, so you can see everything very clearly. But only two of them have alternate faces. This also gives you a better look at the torso print on the back of Blaze, which is really good itself. And on the whole, I think just all three of these are done at a very high caliber. So that's the new AT-ST overall. I am definitely very satisfied with this thing. I'm glad that it can be used in the context of an original trilogy display or diorama. I especially like the head build on this one. The figures are really good. I could do without those blue Technic connector pieces, but fortunately it is possible to get replacements for those for folks who really want to see that gone. With the price to part ratio being below 10 cents in the US, even though this doesn't have too many really tiny pieces in it, I think that the value is very, very strong with this one. Take a moment, if you would, to share your thoughts about the set in a comment down below, including what you like and what you don't like about it. Thank you in advance for your feedback, and thank you for watching. I'll talk to you again soon.